Holy Spirit, come and fill this place. Bring us healing with your warm embrace. Show your power, make your presence known. Holy Spirit, come fill this place. Breath of God, we need a touch from you. Shine down on us with your light of truth.
Stir
our hearts and set our spirit free.
Holy Spirit, come fill this place.
Holy Spirit, come fill this place.
Oh, oh, oh. Our hearts are hungry for your perfect peace. Our souls are thirsty for the joy you bring. So send your glory, make the praise complete. Lord, send down the rain, touch us once again. Send down the rain, my Lord, we need you to touch us once again.
Open our hearts and truly ask the Lord what it is that he wants to speak to us tonight. Hide me. He doesn't need me. We need him. Be in this place, Lord, tonight.
Holy Spirit, come and fill this place. Lord, we're nothing without you. 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 So come fill this place. Come fill your people. 'Cause in your presence there is peace evermore. In your presence,
let it fall.
Come fill.
Come fill
this place.
This place.
We want to be in your presence tonight. We don't want to be anywhere else. I don't want to be anywhere else. You do not need another singer. You do not need another musician. But Lord, we are in desperate need of your presence. Be in this place, God. Hide the one bringing the message. And Lord, may your soul and your spirit and your power shine through. In Christ's name we pray. And all God's people said, amen and amen and amen. Thank you so much for coming and hanging out with me tonight. Can you thank Joshua for sitting back there and playing for me? Or standing back there? Did I take your stool? Okay. Okay. Well, you can sit down. It's going to be a minute. Yeah. Just relax, bro. Seriously. Well, I'm so blessed to be with you guys. I had a great morning over in Madison. How many were in Madison this morning? Nice. Thanks for coming back. Woo!
Forever.
this holy place, a home that's like no other, full of mercy, love, and grace. I know it's been a long time, but I never felt that far, 'cause you were always on my mind, you were always in my heart. So good to be home, where I know that I belong, right here in this house of love, with my family so strong. And we are here to worship and pour out our offering, 'cause in the presence of this love, we're never alone. It's so good to be home. It's so good to be home. Yes, it is. Woo. My Lord, I know I'm always welcome into His open arms. When all of us are gathered, we shine a light into the dark. See, this home is where the heart is, and it's always been that way. You're forever by my side, and I'm always here to stay. So good to be home, where I know that I belong, right here in this house of love, with my family so strong. And we are here to worship, pour out our offering, 'cause in the presence of this love, I'm never alone, though.
I'm never alone.
It's so good to be
home, home, sweet home.
So by faith we believe and proclaim our deepest love, and give our everything, everything to God above us. And when it's cold outside or really hot, it's always warm in here. Oh, yes, it is. So good to be. Now, how many of you know that the family of God can be closer than mothers and fathers and brothers and sisters sometimes? I believe it with my whole heart, and I'm going to claim y'all as my own tonight. Is that okay? It's so good to be home, where I know that I belong, right here in this house. With my family so strong. And Lord, we are here to worship and pour out our offering, 'cause in the presence of your love, I'm never alone. It's so good to be I love it. I'm going to claim y'all as my own, whether you like it or not. So now listen, some of y'all are smiling back at me. You can play. Yeah. You just can't sit up there and just look pretty. You got to work. Some of y'all are just looking at me, and you're smiling, and you're worshiping, and you're in it 100%. And some of y'all are just trying to figure out whether you like me or not. And I got the lights up just enough where I'm doing the same thing to you. No, I'm just kidding. Listen, tonight, I want us just to relax. So we're all going to take a deep breath. Take a deep breath into your nose, out through your mouth. Thank you for brushing your teeth before you came tonight. And we're just going to have some real talk, some real worship, and some honest time together. Is that okay? Because how many of you know sometimes church should be one of the most dishonest places in the whole world? Because we'll come back in that door Sunday after Sunday, Saturday after Saturday, Wednesday, whenever we have something here, and we walk up, brother, how you doing? Sister, how are you? Oh, great, praise the Lord. And inside we are a mess. So we're not going to do any of that fake Christianese stuff tonight, okay? For the next hour or so, hour-ish, we're just going to shake all that off and we're going to be real. I hope that's okay with y'all. Even if it's not, I've got the mic. It's my concert, so I can do what I want. So I asked this morning. This column is just in a really weird, because I'll be talking and like, I can't see you. But isn't it nice to know that you're still thin and can hide behind a column? Isn't that a blessing? So I asked this morning, how many of you ever heard of the group Avalon before? If you've heard of Avalon, raise your hand. Okay, so a few of you, a smattering of Avalonians, as it were. So I spent the better part of 12 years in a group called Avalon. And if you were listening to Christian music at all in the late 1990s, early 2000s, then you'll know Avalon. There was a song, "For as long as I shall live, I will testify to love. I'll be a witness in the silences when words are not enough." Anybody heard that one? See, so you've heard of Avalon then, if you've heard that one. So I never loved that song, by the way, but I had to sing it 9,000 times, so I grew to love it. But I spent the better part of 12 years traveling and singing with them, and recorded 12 studio albums and, probably 120 songs total with them in various things. And somebody asked me the other day what my favorite Avalon song was. And I'm like, I don't know that I could pick a favorite. But I will tell you this. I have two that I love for sure. And I wanted to do a couple for you, if that's okay. Is that all right? Yeah, again, I've got the mic. But I'm asking because I care. All right. So hold that thought, my friend. So I can't decide. I'm going to ask the people who've heard Avalon before. How many of you ever heard the song "You Were There"? Okay. How many of you have ever heard the song "I Don't Want to Go"? You're the same people. We got some diehard Avalon fans here. Okay, so if you had to pick, which one would you rather hear? You Were There, "I Don't Want to Go"? You Were There? You Were There? Okay. All right, well then, I'm going to tell you the story attached to this song. See how that works? Stories and songs. By the way, that's a brand new picture. We took that picture about 2 months ago. It was 700 degrees, I promise it was, in Tennessee. And I was on a friend's property. They have like an area where you're allowed to hunt. They shoot ducks and stuff. And so we went, and it was so hot. And the guy that was taking the pictures for me, he came out and he had two ticks stuck on him. And yeah, so we sacrificed a lot for that picture. And it's really not that great a picture. Anyway, so stories and songs. So this song is interesting because the way that Avalon chose songs, Avalon was a quartet. There's two guys and two girls. And we would sit in a big conference room at our record label, and they would just, because we weren't really songwriters. I am a songwriter, but I didn't. Any of the songs I wrote with Avalon, you haven't heard. They just weren't that good. But we would sit in there and they would just contribute songs, and we would listen to a ton of demos of different things. And if it moved us, we'd put it in the okay pile. If it didn't, we'd. And so this day had gone on forever. Like we had been in there for probably 3 hours at that point. And this was the last song that they played. And our producer said this was written by one guy. One man wrote this song. And he said, "I think it's a bit redundant, but I love what it says." And I'm like, okay. And they played this song. And I wept. I sat there and I cried like a baby. I don't know what journey you're on, but you need to know whatever journey you're on, God has been with you the entire time. He has been there since the beginning of time, and He will be there. He's the beginning and the end, the Alpha and Omega. He will be there in the end. And that's what this song talks about. And I haven't sung it in a minute, so y'all be kind to me, okay? Where is it? Oh, there it is. I have to see. You have to use my glasses. That's what happens when you're 54.
Goliath on a hill. I imagine that he shook with all his might until you took his hand and held on tight. 'Cause you were there in the midst of danger's snare.
You were there, you were there always. You were there when the hardest fight seemed so out of reach. God was there. He's always there. Lord, you're always there. So there he stood upon that hill, Abraham with a knife in his hand was poised to kill. But God in all his sovereignty had a bigger plan, and just in time he brought a lamb. 'Cause you were there, you were there in the midst of the unclear. You were there, you were there always. Oh, you were there when obedience seemed to not make sense. My God was there. Oh, he's always there. Lord, you're always understood you, still there you were, hanging blameless on a cross. You would rather die than leave us in the dark. Now every moment, every plan, coincidence, it all makes sense. With your last breath, during history's darkest hours, and he'll be there always. You were the victor and the king, and you were the power in David's swing. You were the calm in Abraham, and you are the God who understands. You are the strength when we have none. You are the living Holy One. You are, and you will always be the risen Lamb of God. Come on. I have not sung that song in probably 5 years. So that was awesome. I love singing that. Oh, man. I'm going to do the other one just because I can. This is probably my favorite Avalon song, if we're being honest. And I think this is for somebody here tonight, actually. I feel like the Holy Spirit's telling me, do this, because somebody needs to hear it. You changed my world when you came to me, and you drove a passion in my soul down deep, Lord, to follow you in everything. I don't want to go somewhere if I know that you're not there, 'cause I know that me with
miles from home, 'cause my heart needs to be where you are. So I don't wanna go. So come, whatever, my Lord, I'm gonna stick with you. Call me crazy or a fool, oh, I don't care. Lord, for forever, I promise you, I don't wanna go somewhere if I know that you're not there. 'Cause I know that me without you, it's a lie. Without your love filling me like an ocean, and your grace, it's enough, enough for me. To never want to go somewhere if he's not there, 'cause me without you, it's a lie.
Indulging me with that. I have spent a lot of life. I don't know if this is even theologically correct or not, so don't quote me on this, but I spent a lot of life probably in God's permissive will and not his perfect will, because I'm stubborn and hard-headed. I'm sure no one else in here is stubborn and hard-headed. I'm sure you've all done everything God has asked you to do from start to finish. Congratulations. I am not that person. And I am so thankful that God honors ignorance, that he uses me in spite of me. Aren't you thankful for that? Well, I want to tell you a story, so get comfortable. Everybody okay? You're okay, say amen. All right. Are you glad you came? All right, well, the doors are locked. You can't leave. So I sang with Avalon up until 2007, and then I left in 2007. We'll talk about that in a minute. And I took about a 12-year hiatus where I didn't sing anywhere. I didn't sing at my church. I sat and listened to people sing. And to be honest, I was having a pity party, but it was also kind of fantastic because I was letting somebody else do the work for once. And I enjoyed it, and I got the chance to actually go to church and worship. But God was doing a great work in my life then, and there's so many things I'll tell you when we'll get into that in a minute. But that's not true. I guess about 12 years, close to 12 years into that hiatus, in 2013, I got a phone call. Now, I used to be in this group called Truth. Has anybody ever heard of a group called Truth? One person. Did you say yes? Do you know Truth? You don't? Really? I thought you knew all the singing people. Well, Truth was this group that traveled all over the country. I joined them right out of college, and we stayed on the road all year long. It was chaos. And so Roger Breland, the founder of this group, he actually wrote the foreword to my book. So if you want to go to Amazon and buy my book, it's there. If you don't, that's fine too. But he just kind of became like a second dad to me. And so about 12 years in this hiatus, I get a phone call one day, and it's Roger. And he says, Jody, can you be in Africa by Friday? And it was Wednesday. And I said, I don't even know if that's physically possible. And he goes, well, I got somebody that needs you to sing. And I'm like, well, I'm not sure if you've noticed. I'm not doing a whole lot of that lately. He goes, I know, that's why I called you. You need to get out there and sing again. And I said, okay. And I said, can I be there by Friday? He goes, well, let me see if I can work it out. So I packed my bags that night, got on a plane Thursday afternoon, and I landed in Uganda on Friday. And that trip started a 4-year journey of me leading worship for the pastor, Benny Hinn. How many of you ever heard of Benny Hinn before? Yeah, see how many people? Now, this is not about Benny Hinn. I don't have a whole lot to say either way. I'll just let you decide what the Holy Spirit wants to tell you about him, because it's not my job to tell you what to think or not to think. All I know is I grew up Baptist, okay? So you have to understand, I grew up Baptist, and I travel all over the world and been in different churches. I believe in the power of the Holy Spirit. I think God can do whatever he wants to do. He doesn't need my permission to do it, okay? If God wants to heal, he'll heal. If God wants to make somebody take a lap around the church, he'll make them take a lap around the church. And I'm not going to sit and judge anybody. Amen? Amen. So I went out there with an open mind, and it was so interesting because a couple years into this, you know, I'd be sitting there leading worship. And if you've ever seen a Benny Hinn crusade, people fall and they get slain in the spirit, and the power of God moves. And at the time, I wasn't sure how I felt about all that, and I wasn't going to manufacture it. So we would be in a couple places. There was a couple places where there were literally like 600 people on the platform, pastors and singers and a choir, and they would just all be littered, like falling out, littered on the stage, and I'm standing in the middle of them singing. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. And he'd be walking around in a fury, and the Holy Spirit would be moving. He'd just look at me and go, oh, and just keep walking. And so I remember one time he came backstage after the service. He said, Jody, why do you resist the Holy Spirit? And I said, I'm not resisting the Holy Spirit. I'm not going to fall for a paycheck. When the Holy Spirit moves and knocks me over legitimately, I will fall. But I'm not going to manufacture it. Literally the next week, God got my attention. So in my life at this time, there was a whole lot going on, which we will get into later. But about 4 years into my time with Benny, well, about 3 years in, Benny started getting death threats from people. Things started kind of getting kind of messy. And they felt like, for insurance purposes, anybody that was on the platform with him had to have security. So we had this big meeting we were in this conference room, and there were about 12 of us that were on the platform, and they hired 12 security guys. And these guys, I'm talking former special forces in the Army, I mean, literally no neck, 6'6", 285 pounds, tattooed from neck to toe. I mean, these guys were tough hombres, okay? And so they're going down the list and saying each person and who their detail was, who their person was. And they get to my security guy, we'll just say his name is Brad, and they said, Brad, you're with Jody McBrayer. And he goes, and I said, I feel safer already. He wanted to guard the big guy. He didn't want to guard the little peon singer guy. But I wore him down. And within 6 months, Brad and I were friends. And I knew that Brad would do what it took to make me safe. And so I didn't have him in the United States, but anytime we traveled overseas, which was 90% of the time, Brad was with me. And so Brad and I at this point had been together for a year and a half. And we traveled all over the world together. We had experienced great things together. But Brad was not a believer. As a matter of fact, he would make a mockery of it most of the time. And there were moments where I saw that Brad was listening and he tried to act like he wasn't. But God was doing something. So cut to the next to the last trip that I took with Benny Hinn. I was exhausted emotionally and physically. A lot was going on in my life. And we were doing a week and a half long tour of Africa. And it ended in a place called Equatorial Guinea, which is literally right on the equator, a little island. It's kind of in the armpit of Africa right there, you know, that little curve. And as you can imagine, it's on the equator, so it's 648 degrees. And we were exhausted. This was the end of our trip. We flew into Equatorial Guinea and get off the plane and get on these buses, and the buses are going to take us to our hotel. And true to form with Africa, there's just a lot of poverty. It's filthy. Now, this is where we're going to be super honest, okay? I'm going to be real and I'm going to be honest with you. Can I do that? If I can, say amen. And you're not going to judge me, say amen. I don't like dirt. I am OCD clean. I am 2 showers a day. I wear cologne. I wear deodorant. I'm just not that kind of person, you know? Like my daughter, she'll go 3 or 4 days without washing her hair. I'm like, you did what? You know, it freaks me out. But she goes, it works better when it's not washed, Dad. So whatever. But that freaks me out. So I struggled. And if you've ever been to Africa, and some of y'all are judging me, you've got that look on your face like, he's weird. And listen, I know I'm weird. Jesus loves me. Africa is just Africa. Like, it's dirty and it smells and it's just a lot. The people are wonderful. They're so kind. But it's difficult. And so I went there with a really bad attitude. Okay? I'm just being real. Met some of the most unbelievable people God ever placed on this earth. Equatorial Guinea, the end of the trip, we were exhausted. We had had several issues, travel issues, passport issues, all kinds of things. We get on the bus, we pass by the soccer arena where the event's going to be the next day. Huge soccer arena. It's in the rough part of town. And then we come up to this guard shack. And this guard shack is like 6 or 7 gates long, and it goes up the hill. There's a giant wall that goes up the hill. There's 6 guard shacks, and then it goes down into the ocean. And so you can't see what's on the other side. And there's armed police and armed, you know, military guys there. And we stopped the bus. Apparently, we had the right to go through the gate because they lifted the thing, and we went to the gate. And on the other side of the gate was the most unbelievable houses you've ever seen in your life. Like, Beverly Hills has nothing on this place. So it was very obvious to me who was making the money and who was working for who here, okay? And our hotel happened to be on that side. We pull up to the hotel, we unpack our bags, and as we're going into our rooms, the person that was the coordinator for our travel said, Pastor Benny would like to have lunch with the staff at 2:00. And we're like, okay. So we go put our bags down, we come back downstairs, and there's about, I'd say maybe 15 or 20 of us at this long table. And I sat as far away from Pastor Benny as I could because he loves to tell stories, and I was just exhausted. And I was kind of hiding behind Brad because he's like a wall. And as we're eating, I hear Pastor Benny go, Jody. And so I kind of hide more behind Brad. And he goes, brother, I see you. Quit trying to hide behind Bradley. And so I look down and he goes, Jody, tomorrow at the event, I want you to pray for the sick. And he keeps eating. And I'm kind of like, what? Again, being honest, in my heart and in my mind, I'm like, I'm the singer. That's not what I do. His right-hand guy, a guy named Jim Sinero, was sitting across the table from me. He goes, don't worry about it. I'll walk you through the process. Just be down here at 1:00. I was like, 1:00? Because the event doesn't start till 7. I'm like, we go over at 1? You know how hot it is at 1? Such a bad attitude. So Brad and I come down the next day at 1:00 in full suit and tie, I might add. And we go over to the soccer arena, and at 1:00, it's already 10,000 people. It's packed. And you get out of the car, and the wall of heat and Africa just hits you in the face. And we get there, and they speak French in Equatorial Guinea, so the local pastor gets up on the platform and through the PA says, Benny Hinn's staff is here to pray for anybody who needs a miracle. If you need a miracle, raise your hand, and 9,800 hands go up, okay? And nobody's told me what to do. I'm like, what do we do? And Brad's like, I don't know. And they gave me an interpreter because I don't speak French. So it was Brad and me an interpreter. And as we're starting, they said, okay, so let's go pray. Jim comes and finds me and goes, hey, here's what you do. You ask the person that raises their hand what they need God to do, and they'll tell you, and you pray for them. And if God doesn't heal them, you tell them their miracle's on the way, and you move on to the next person. And I'm like, that's it? He's like, that's it. I'm like, okay, I can do that. It's weird, but I'll do it. So we make our way through the crowd, and I pray for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 people. And it's hot, and nothing happens. And I'm like, your miracle's on the way. Keep praying. Your miracle's on the way. Keep praying. And before I know it, a couple of hours have passed, and I've sweat through my clothes, and Brad's getting irritated and pulling at his collar, and the sweet interpreter is just kind of following us along and not saying much of anything. She was precious. And I'm finally look at Brad and go, bro, I'm done. I said, are you done? He's like, oh, I'm so done. I said, all right, will you take me back? He's like, yeah. And so there was a huge center aisle down the middle of this soccer arena. And I was probably as far away from backstage as the back wall. And so I said, let's go. And so Brad grabs my arm. And as we go, this woman steps out into the alley, the aisle, and starts waving me down. Young girl, probably in her early 30s. And I made eye contact with her. So I'm like, I got to stop. I can't not pray for this girl, you know. And so as I'm walking towards her, I get closer to her. And she steps to the left, and I notice that there is an old woman holding onto her dress behind her, a short old woman who is hunched over. And the old woman lifts her head and is looking around, and there's white covering her eyes. And I thought, no. She's going to ask me to pray for that woman to get her sight back. And I don't know how to do that. This isn't about you. As clear as I'm talking to you, I heard someone say, this isn't about you. Now, you have to understand, I mean, it's like full on, I mean, everywhere. Like, people are going nuts and screaming and hollering. It's just chaos, okay? And so I look at Brad. I'm like, did you say something? He's like, bruh, we're in Africa. Everybody's saying something. I'm like, okay. So I go up to this girl, and she tells me her name. And through the interpreter, I say, what is it that you need God to do? And she turns to her grandmother and she says, this is my grandmother. She has not seen since she was 12 years old. She's gone almost her entire life without seeing. She's never seen my face, never seen her grandchildren, never seen her kids, anything. And she goes, I want God to restore her sight. Just full on full of faith. And when she said, I want God to restore her sight, I said, in my mind, I'm like, I don't know how to do that. And this time, the Holy Ghost hairs stood up all over my body, and I felt his presence say, Jody, this is not about you. And man, I'm just telling you, so I will cry like a baby telling this story, but I want to say something before I go any further. Some things are true whether you believe them or not. I'll say that again. Some things are true whether you believe them or not. It is of no consequence to me whether or not you believe this story I'm about to tell. I was there, and all I know is it changed the course of my life forever. I will minister for the rest of my life because of this story. So if you choose not to believe it, then you choose to limit a God who is limitless. And that's all I'll say. So through the interpreter, I never spoke directly to the old woman. I don't know why I didn't. It wasn't on purpose, and I didn't mean to condescend to her at all, but I think I was freaked out by the situation. And I said, will you ask your grandmother if it's okay if I put my hands on her eyes? Because that's what Jesus did in the Bible, and I remember as a kid reading those Bible stories and how immature I was in all of it. And so she asked her grandmother, and her grandmother shook her head. And she was so short, y'all. I went like this and put my hands on her eyes. And I prayed probably the most immature prayer you've ever heard. I don't remember what it was. But I do remember at the end, I said, Lord, you have made it crystal clear that this is not about me. So if it be your will, restore this woman's sight, please. And I took my hands off her eyes. And I have to tell you, that because I knew I heard from the Holy Spirit, I half expected like doves to fly out of her ears and a rainbow to appear and, you know, all this stuff. And nothing happened. Nothing. And she just stood there and with the, you know, glaze over her eyes and just kind of going like this, sort of like waiting for something, and nothing happened. And even her granddaughter was kind of like looking at me and looking at her. And I was like, I don't know. And so I was getting ready to give her the company line. Your miracle's on the way. Keep praying. Your miracle's on. And the woman starts screaming, and I thought, I've killed this woman. And I look over at her, and she's clawing at her eyes. And then she pulls her hands back, and she opens her eyes, and she looks up at the sky. And I watch the white of her pupils get absorbed, or the white that was covering them get absorbed into her pupils. And I saw brown eyes underneath. And she grabs the face of her granddaughter and says, I see you. and all of Africa goes crazy. Just, you know, nuts. And I looked at Brad, I've never seen Brad like this. I mean, you have to understand, special forces, the dude has killed for a living. And he's standing there with his mouth wide open. And I look at him, I said, I want to go. And he said, me too. And they were so busy, people were so busy celebrating that he pulled me away. And we went backstage. And he sat across the room from me in the only air-conditioned room we could find, thank God. And he stared at me for probably 30 minutes and wouldn't speak. And I said, buddy, you got to say something because I'm freaking out here. And he looked at me and he said, you don't understand. I have taken life with my own hands. I've never seen anybody give life. And I said, I didn't do anything. Like, you know, in the scriptures with the woman with the issue of blood where Jesus said, I felt the healing power leave. I felt nothing. Except my own ignorance and stupidity. That woman came across the stage and testified to what God had done, and I felt so insignificant, and just, I didn't even say anything. Like, they were celebrating and people were going crazy that she had received her sight, and I stood back in the back with my microphone and just watched. And wept, and I looked down at Brad, and Brad would not even make eye contact. He was just staring ahead. We got on a plane the next day and flew home, and that's a long flight. And Brad wouldn't speak, wouldn't talk to me. I think he was scared. And we got to New York, and Brad lives in California, and so he passed me off and said, I'll send you the day sheet for next week, and our last trip together was going to be the Holy Land. And so he didn't talk to me the entire week, and the night before I was supposed to leave, he sent me all my information and said, I'll meet you in Tel Aviv. And I was like, okay. So I landed in Tel Aviv, and I walked through security after an hour and a half of security, and Brad was standing there with my bags, and he said, let's go. And we got in the car and drove for an hour and a half to Jerusalem, and he didn't speak to me the entire drive. And I'm like, what's going on? I said, are you ever going to talk to me? What's going on? He says, I'm collating. I said, what does that mean? Can you speak in non-military code, please? He goes, I'm just processing. Okay. So we get there, and we have to go in. We checked into the King David Hotel, and we had to go in and change our clothes because we had to go baptize 250 people in the Jordan River. So we go and change our clothes, go to the Jordan River, and I'm standing in waders in the Jordan River helping people down to baptize, and Brad's standing up on the shore with his sunglasses on, with his arms folded, just kind of staring. And I knew something was going on. We get finished baptizing. We get back in the car and go back to the hotel, and we're exhausted. And he lets me in my door and shuts the door, and then he's in the connector next to me. And he goes, I hear him go in his door and shut the door. And then I hear a knock on the connecting door. And I open it, and this giant man is weeping like a child. And he says, do you think that that same God who healed that woman can forgive me of all the things I've done and give me a chance to be with him in eternity? And I said, brother, I know we can. And that big lug got on his knees in my hotel room and prayed the most irreverent prayer you've ever heard in your life. I'm pretty sure he cursed twice. But here's the beauty of that, you guys. Jesus said, I'll clean you up later. Come on home. Come on home. And to me, it was almost as big a miracle watching Brad receive Christ as it was that woman receive her sight. And I'm angry sometimes at myself for not realizing that God does that, because he still does that. We don't see it here because we doubt he can, but he can. When he says in his word, I'm able to do immeasurably. Immeasurable means you can't measure it. I'm able to do immeasurably more than you could ever ask or imagine. And yet we limit him in our own lives. I will never limit him again, ever. I wrote this song based on my experiences. And I want you to know, you can go ahead. Anything is possible in the presence of Jesus. In his presence, sickness, disease, heartache, brokenness, thank you. They cannot exist. It's the video track, thank you.
One came through the rooftop, held by friends. One crawled through the crowd alone to touch the garment's hem. Some would come with tears, some would come with faith. One thing that was certain, no one left the same. No one left the same. Bring your broken body, bring your broken heart. Come all weak and weary, come just as you are. There is hope and healing, there's power, I believe it. Anything is possible in the presence of Jesus. Oh, I believe. None of us deserve his kind of grace, yet he still invites us all to come and be amazed. So tell him what your need is, place it in his hands. Who knows what could happen now, or what great things he's planned. Oh, such great things God's planned. Bring your broken bodies and bring your broken heart. Come all weak and weary, come just as you are. There is hope and healing, there's power, I believe it. Anything is possible in the presence of Jesus. Oh, I believe, I believe. The compassion of the Savior, it's never ending. The wonder of his power never fails. No, he has never missed a single prayer you've lifted from anyone who's called upon his you are. There is hope and healing, there's power, I believe it. Anything is possible in the presence of Jesus. Oh, I believe that anything is possible in the presence of Jesus. I believe, I believe.
Do you believe? The Bible says if we have the faith the grain of a mustard seed, we can say to the mountain, mountain, move, and it'll move. Nothing will be impossible for you. A mustard seed, it's about that big. I grew up in the Baptist church. My father was a Baptist pastor. He was a postmaster by trade, was in the military. He reminded me a lot of Brad, without the muscles. But he was a postmaster by trade, but Baptist church, Baptist pastor. I started going on the, I went to a Baptist college. I went to Liberty University. I started going on the road, found out God wasn't Baptist, and it hurt my feelings a little bit, I'm being honest. But the great thing about God is he is not a Baptist or a Presbyterian or a Catholic or a Methodist or a Pentecostal, or he's so much bigger than that. And I guarantee you, we're going to get to heaven one day. We're going to be like, yo, I didn't know y'all were coming. Seriously. So glad you're here. But I think that God is a whole lot bigger. And until we start realizing that God is a big God, we're not going to see him do big things in our life. We keep putting him in a little box and limiting who he is. And just FYI, God's not going to stay in a box. He's going to be who he is, whether we like it or not. But why don't we just open ourselves up to the possibilities that he can do more and just watch him do more? But I grew up in the Baptist church, and I cut my musical teeth on the hymns of the church. And a lot of the young people, I can say young people because I'm 54. I still feel young. I feel like I'm still 16. But a lot of kids, they don't know, understand or appreciate the value of the hymns. And what I want to tell you is that these were the worship songs before there were worship songs. And what's even more so is these songs were written when they didn't have anything but Jesus. And he was enough for them. They didn't have cell phones. Like, I think all the time about the story of It Is Well With My Soul. Who knows the story about It Is Well With My Soul? A lot of you do. It's a very well-known story about the Spaffords, about his daughters dying in a shipwreck, in a shipping accident. I'll got to tell you, you know, he had the captain wake him when he was over the spot where the daughter's ship went down. And he went out on the bow of the ship and wrote, "Whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul." I got to tell you, I'm not sure I would feel that way if my wife and my daughter had perished. Which, by the way, I didn't do this. Would you like to see a picture of my wife and my daughter? Sure you would. Let's put a picture up. Let's do the other one. That's far away. That's us in Hawaii, though. There they are. My daughter is so tan in that picture. But that's my beautiful wife and daughter. Stephanie is my wife. And then Sarah Clayton is my daughter. She's 19, and that was at her grad party that we had for her. And she started the University of Mississippi this week, and we're not real sure how we feel about that. But God be with her. I just thought it'd be cool if we sang some hymns, if that's okay. So if you have a hymn you'd like to sing, we're going to try to stump Joshua here. You got this. It's not going to happen. I know. I believe in you. Why don't we sing that one? Let's sing that first one. It is well with my soul. Okay, let's sing When Peace Like a River. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll. Whatever my lot, I love this line. Split the room down the middle. Left side starts.
It is well.
Right.
It is well with my soul. With my soul.
Everybody. Favorite verse of this song is the part that says, though Satan should buffet. To buffet means to hit with fists. And for those of you that have heard about the year that we've had, losing my wife's brother and just several different things along the way, and I'm sure some of you can relate that some days it just feels like Satan is just beating the tar out of you. But I love what it says.
though Satan should buffet, though trials should come.
I love this.
Let this blessed assurance control.
Love it.
That Christ has regarded my helpless estate and has shed his own blood for my soul.
Let's start on this side. Come on, y'all, sing it. Everybody, come on.
It is well. It is well with my soul.
Sing that again.
It is well. It is well with my soul.
I don't write them like that anymore. Okay, who's got another one? Let's sing another one. Who wants to raise their hands? Yes. Blessed assurance.
Blessed assurance.
A swing on it.
Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine.
Heir of salvation.
Heir of salvation.
Purchased of God.
Purchased of God.
Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood.
Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood.
This is my story. Come on, lift it up.
This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long.
Yes. I love it. How about another one? How about somebody over here? Why are you shy? Seriously? I thought you were Pentecostals. Yes, ma'am. Old rugged cross. Okay. What do you think? Let's see.
On a hill.
I'm going to say, on a hill far away stood an old rugged cross. The emblem.
The emblem.
I love that old cross. Come on.
And I love that old cross
where the dearest and best.
Where the dearest and best.
Oh, the world.
Oh, the world of lost sinners was slain.
So I'll cherish.
So I'll cherish.
Cling. That's good singing, y'all. Hey, we need to get a big old bus and hit the road. All right, who else? Come on, let's do a couple more. This is too fun. Yes, ma'am. Amazing Grace. I'm not sure I know that one. I'm just kidding.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
We gotta sing "When We've Been There." Come on. Church a little on that one. You put a little stank on it. I heard it. A couple more. Somebody over here? Yes, ma'am. Sorry? Oh, mansion over a hillside. Hilltop. Okay, I know it, but I don't know it. So if y'all know it, do you know it? I know it's, I've got a mansion just over the hill. In that bright land. Go.
And someday yonder we'll never more wander. I forget the rest. And wait, the streets that are purest gold.
Yes. Who sang that song originally? What's that? You did. We stumped both of us. I'm not sure what you win, but you win. Bragging rights. Let's do one more. Yes, sir. Battle Hymn of the Republic. Okay. Let's see. You don't have to play it. You look at you. You're just crossing your arms. Let me find a good key. Give me C.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has moved his faithening of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on.
I feel like I have to sing.
God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with a light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans wide with foam. God bless America, my home.
getting all the patriotic feels now. Woo! So, you know, I was telling you about my dad, and I want to just say a really quick thing about him. So my mom was born in Spain, and she's an incredible woman. She's crazy. And she just very... My mother did a really good job of taking care of our physical needs. She was a great cook. She took care of our clothes, all those things. But my dad was the emotional, surprisingly. And he was really Jesus with skin on. Just an example of Christ. He led me to the Lord when I was 16. And my dad was military. He was in the Air Force and just kind of rough around the edges. I said he reminded me of Brad without the muscles, and he was a lot like Brad. But when Jesus saved my dad's life, man, he came in like a flood. And all my dad wanted to do for the rest of his life was tell people about Jesus in his own way. My dad died in 2000. He was 56 years old. I'm 54, so it's hard to believe that I'm that close. And, you know, that was sort of the catalyst that started a bunch of stuff in me. And we'll talk about that in a second, but this was my dad's favorite hymn. Give me an F if you don't mind. I don't know if that's F. If you don't mind, I want to sing this one for you. You'll know it. But I sang this at his memorial service, and I don't know, it makes me feel close to him. I come to the garden alone. Died in 2000, and in 2006 I found out that I had a degenerative form of heart disease. My muscle atrophies or dies off, and at that point I had lost 19% of my heart muscle function. And my wife was working at a record label in Nashville, and I was with Avalon, and we were doing 280 dates a year. And we were like two ships passing in the night. We never saw each other. Our marriage was dysfunctional. It was an absolute catastrophe, if I'm being honest. My daughter at the time was 2 years old. And I started going to counselors and doctors. And all of them said, Jody, you have to change your life. Emotionally, physically, spiritually, you're dying. And if you don't make a change now, it's going to be catastrophic for you and for your marriage. So in 2007, I quit Avalon in July of 07. In September of 07, my wife quit Sony Music, and we came home and started putting broken pieces of a family back together. Marriage is tough. And don't worry about the baby. He's fine. Babies cry. That's how it goes. Sorry. It's okay, buddy. We love you. Sweet thing. I felt like crying like that a couple days ago. But that's what began the hiatus for me. And I didn't know at the time, and we don't talk about this a lot in church, but when my dad passed away, I was starting to slip slowly into depression. It's like a demon, and it just sneaks up on you. And then the heart disease, and then my marriage almost falling apart, and my wife and I were separated for a short time. And came home, and thankfully we've been married 25 years this year, praise God. About 2.5 years into that hiatus, my wife and I went to a redneck wedding in Hickman County, Tennessee. Some will argue, is there any other kind of wedding in Hickman County, Tennessee? And you would be correct in saying there is not. But it was a beautiful wedding for a friend of ours. It was outdoors. And after it was over, we drove home, and my wife's like, let's go for a swim. I said, okay. And so she was putting on her swimsuit, and I hear screaming coming from the bathroom. And she's like, there's a tick in me. Get it out. And she's freaking out. And so I walk in there, and sure as the world, right here, there was a tick under her right breast. And I said, well, what do I do? I don't know. And I'm Googling how to get a tick out, and she's freaking out. And so we eventually got the tick out, and it kind of left a little spot. We put some alcohol on it and went swimming, didn't think anything of it. Within 3 weeks, my wife was the sickest I've ever seen anybody in my life. Within a month, she could not move. Every joint in her body was swollen. She had, her hands were double in size. And you saw the picture. My wife is not a big girl. And she, her knees were twice the size of mine. And my daughter, who was about 4 years old at the time, would come and pull at her nightgown on the couch and say, Mommy, play with me. And she's like, baby, I can't. And she would just be weeping. And nobody could give her relief. And we went to doctor after doctor trying to figure out what was wrong. Spent every penny we had in savings trying to get help for her. We finally ended up going to a neurologist who exhausted everything and then said at the end, have you ever been bit by a tick? And she goes, yeah, last year. And she's like, well, I want to run a test for you and see if you have Lyme's. And she had Lyme's off the charts. So at the time, there wasn't a whole lot of information about how to deal with Lyme's disease. So we had a friend who's in a Christian band whose dad is a holistic doctor in Atlanta, Georgia. And he said, you need to come see my dad. My dad has dealt with Lyme's patients and had great success. Now you have to understand, I have heart disease. So I go to a normal doctor. In my mind, a holistic doctor is some dude with a bone in his nose, you know, hook-a-booga. You know, I don't know anything about that. And of course, it's not covered under insurance. So I'm like, this should be fun. Well, we went into this doctor's office, and the first thing he did was prayed with my wife. And he looked at her and held her hands, and as she wept, and she was in so much pain, you guys, and when your wife is in pain like that, you will charge hell with a squirt gun if that's what it takes. And he looked at her and said, you're not going to die from this, and we're going to get through this together. That was in February. We went several times, and there were some moments where I thought the cure was going to kill her before the disease did. But by December, we were going down for her last checkup of the year, and she was smiling and laughing. And she looked at me, she goes, I'm telling you, I'm healed. And it was the best Christmas present she ever got. And my wife is Lyme's free today. But Lyme's took its toll on her reproductive system. We tried to get pregnant several times again. We miscarried twice, once pretty quickly, and then once in the second trimester. And that one, they both were gut-wrenching, but that one was extremely hard. So we said, well, we live in Franklin, Tennessee. Everybody has two of their own and two from China. We'll adopt. And so we have a friend who has an adoption agency, a Christian artist, and he said he would help us. And so we did all the paperwork and got approved, and what a nightmare it is to get approved to help children, but you got to go through it. And the day after we got approved, his wife calls and says, you're not going to believe this, but there's a woman in Memphis, Tennessee who is 3 months pregnant with a baby girl, and she wants to know if you want her. And we're like, yes. Does the Pope wear a funny hat? So we got in the car the next day, drove to Memphis, met this mother. She loved us. We loved her. For all intents and purposes, this baby girl was going to be ours. We filled out the paperwork. We started paying her medical expenses, doing all the things we could to help her because she was a single mother. We decorated a nursery. and painted it the most god-awful pink you've ever seen in your life?
Oh, it's beautiful, isn't it?
Sure. And we had her name stenciled on the wall, Caroline James McBrayer. And they were excited. My wife and I were excited. My daughter was excited. And then about 2.5 months later, we get that phone call. 2 a.m. Mr. McBrayer, this is Janice from Le Bonheur Children's Hospital. We wanted you to know that the mother went on a drug and alcohol binge. And Caroline was born prematurely. We had to deliver, and she's not expected to make it through the night. Is there any way you can get here? And I got there just in time to have that tiny little baby wrap her hand around my pinky, and I said goodbye to her. And she is buried in a cemetery in Memphis, Tennessee. Let me tell you something. I was so deep in depression and so deep in despair, and that was the straw that broke the camel's back for me. My wife and I got in the car after we buried Caroline, and she said, I can't go back home right now. I can't see that nursery. I can't do it. And so I called some friends of ours who have a beach house on the panhandle, and I said, can we please go to your house for a couple of days? I said, we'll clean it, we'll pay for whatever. And they said, absolutely. And so we just drove straight down to the beach, my daughter and my wife and I. And at 3 a.m., while my daughter and my wife slept in the bed, I walked out the front door of that house and across the street to the Gulf of Mexico. And I looked up at a sky full of stars. And I put my toes in the water and I said to God, you're not there. I've heard my whole life that you wouldn't put more on me than I could bear, which is not biblical, by the way. But I've heard that my whole life, and I don't think you're paying attention, because I'm dying down here, and I just don't want to do this anymore. And the whole time I'm weeping and crying out to God, I'm going farther and farther into the water. And at this point, the water is lapping up on my chest, and I don't know if it's my tears or if it's the ocean that I'm tasting, but at that point, I was like, I don't want to do this anymore. And I took a deep breath and thought, I'm going to go in and I'm not coming out. They'll think that I went for a swim and I drown, and my life insurance will cover my daughter and my wife, and I'll be with my dad, and I'll be with Caroline, and I'll be with my grandparents, and it won't hurt anymore. And I went all the way in that water and submerged myself. And I opened my eyes, and I was laying in my bed, and the sun was shining in the window, and there were wet beach sand in the sheets, so I had obviously been in the water. And I heard my wife and my daughter downstairs laughing. And I don't know how I got back in my bed. And I think God took me out of that water and put me back in my bed. And some of you say, I don't believe that. And I say this with all the love in my heart. I don't care. I went and got in a broom closet upstairs, and I called my best friend, who's a pastor of a church in California. Yes, they have churches in California. And I told him that entire story, and he cried with me, and he prayed with me, and then he said, buddy, I'm scared. And I said, I'm scared. He goes, you need to talk to somebody. Listen, I know this clinical psychologist in Nashville who is an unbelievable Christian, and he can walk you through this. If you can get home in a couple of days, he will see you. And I said, okay. So I went to this clinical psychologist, and I told him the entire story, bless his heart. Actually, bless my heart, because I was paying by the hour. But at the end of it, he said, what do you want from me, Jody? What is it that you want me to say? And I said, you know what? I just don't want to hear Jeremiah 29:11 again. And I don't mean any disrespect to the Word of God. It's the foundation that our faith is built on, but sometimes Christians have the most disingenuous responses. And when you go through difficult times, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, to prosper you, not to harm you. You just hold on, you know, and it's like, I said, I just need God to show up and do something real. And that's how far gone I was, you guys. He had plucked me out of the Gulf of Mexico and put me back in my bed, and I didn't even know it. So here's my question to Fusion Church in Lexington, Ohio tonight. Where in the water are you? Some of you are just standing right at the shore and the water, the waves are just lapping at your toes and life is good. I'm happy. I genuinely am happy for you. Some of you, it's up to your knees. Some of you, it's up to your waist and things are not looking good. Some of you, you are drowning. Remember how I said we were going to be honest in church? Here's where the rubber meets the road tonight. I don't know where you are, but I know that God loves you enough that he doesn't want you to stay there. So if you need God to do something significant in your life right now, tonight, if you need a miracle, I'm going to ask you to stand up. And I know it's awkward. Thank you so much. But if you need God to do something, I want you to stand right now. Right now. I know it's late. We're almost done. Come on. Don't be shy. Please. I know there's more, and people aren't standing because they think somebody's going to see you. Let me tell you something. If you let pride get in the way of what God needs to do in your life, then God will never move in your life the way he needs to. There's no magic in staying. All it is you putting the gauntlet down and drawing a line in the sand and saying, I'm sick and tired, and I need God to do something significant in my life. Who else will stand? I'm standing. We need significant help in our family. Thank you, 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 thank you. Okay, so here's the deal. If you're not standing, I don't want anybody standing by themselves, so I'm going to ask everybody to get up from their seat, and we're going to gather around people, and we're going to lay hands on everybody that's standing up. If there's somebody next to you, put your hand on them. If you see somebody across the way that doesn't have someone, put your hand on their shoulder. I don't want anybody by themselves, because this is the church. Let me say this really quick as you're moving. Sometimes in church, we do a really great job of looking out for one another. And then sometimes in church, we do a really good job of nothing. If we don't take care of one another here, if this place isn't a hospital where we come and we get healed and we get our wounds bound and we get reprioritized and refocused on Jesus Christ, if we don't do that here, how in the world are we going to go out there and tell them about Jesus? This is the church. I can't see because of the lights, but if anybody's standing alone, look around, Christian. If you see somebody standing by themselves, I don't want them standing by themselves. Okay, I want you to bow your heads, everybody, and we're going to pray. I want the people who have hands on those that were standing to pray silently, or you can pray out loud, or you can pray in the spirit, whatever you need to do. And I'm going to pray over every single one of you right now. Father God, before we come with you to you with any requests or any needs, we worship and praise your holy name. You are worthy to be praised. Hallowed be your name, Father God. Your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Father, my friends are standing because they're in the water. They're desperate. I'm standing because I'm in the water and I'm desperate for a touch from you. We need you, Jesus. And we're tired of being beat up. We're tired of being buffeted by the enemy. God, there's some people who are standing right now who need a physical healing in Jesus' name. We believe 100% that you are still a God that heals, that same power that healed in the times of biblical days is available to us today. I have seen it, I believe it, and no one will ever be able to tell me otherwise. You heal still today. So, Lord, I want to say this first and foremost before we get any further. Satan, you have no place here. In the name of Jesus, you must leave. No demonic forces are allowed to be in this place. This is a holy place, and by the blood of the Lamb and the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, you are gone in Jesus' name. Father God, I pray your spirit will fall right now. Fill every corner, every heart. Lord, I believe where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is healing, there is freedom, there is liberty, there is peace. And we need it. For my friends who are standing in need of a healing touch, I pray you will touch their bodies in Jesus' name. I don't know what it is. Maybe there's somebody here who's got a cancer diagnosis. Maybe there's somebody here who is sick. Maybe there's somebody who's pregnant and it's a critical pregnancy. Maybe there's somebody here who is praying and standing on behalf of someone else who's sick, standing in the gap. I don't know what it is, God. But I do know what it's like to walk hand in hand with somebody who is struggling and they're ill. I know what it's like to be ill myself, Lord, but I also know what it's like to watch my God heal. And your healing power is available to all of us today. So I pray in the mighty name of Jesus that healing take place right now in the bodies of those that are standing. From the top of their head to the bottom of their toes, Lord, I pray that every chromosome that is out of whack will be healed in Jesus' name. Every cell that is infested with cancer will be bound in the name of Jesus and healed by the blood of the Lamb. I pray that everyone who is standing in infirmity will be cleansed in the name of Jesus. God, I pray for the people who are standing, who are struggling in their relationships. There may be some people standing in the gap for their marriage. A wife standing for her husband. A husband standing for her wife, for his wife. They just don't know what to do. They don't know how to move forward. And the enemy has blinded them from the truth, has made them forget what made them fall in love in the first place, has made them forget the copious amounts of grace that they've been given through the blood. Sometimes we forget to forgive, even though we've been given forgiveness beyond what we deserve. So I pray for marriages right now in Jesus' name that they be healed right now. Satan, you have no power or authority over these marriages. They are covered by the blood of Christ. I pray that couples will remember why they fell in love. I pray that they'll be quick to say, I'm sorry, quick to say, I forgive you, quick to remember that no weapon formed against them will prosper. Help them to stand on the promise that you will redeem and restore in Jesus' name. There may be some people here right now who need a financial miracle. You are struggling financially, and you need God to move and to intervene. If he does not intervene, that it could be a catastrophic response. Lord, you own not only the cattle on 1,000 hills, but thousands and thousands and thousands of hills. You own it all. It's all yours. And God, I know that you see people in their need. I pray that you meet them right now in the place that they are and you fulfill their need in Jesus' name. Whatever it is that they need, whatever bills need to be paid, Father, whatever debts they need to be paid. Lord, I even pray for grace in those debts. I pray that if it's someone that they owe money to, that that person will call them and say, your debt has been paid. You no longer owe money. Whatever it is, God, I pray right now that your Holy Spirit will move. Break the hearts of the debtors, Lord. Break the hearts of those who money is owed to. May your Holy Spirit move in them. Lord, provide for the needs of your children. Bible says, I've never seen the righteous forsaken or their seed begging for bread. Lord, we're not begging. We're just asking because you told us we can. So provide all the needs in Jesus' name. There may be some parents here who are struggling with their children or grandparents who are struggling with their grandchildren. There may be some grandchildren here who are struggling with their parents or their family. I know that the enemy knows exactly how to tear us down, and it's straight to the family structure. If he can destroy and dismantle the family, he has us. Not today, Satan. Not today. I pray a covering over families in Jesus' name. I pray for forgiveness in Jesus' name. I pray that parents and grandparents will have a blast of memory as to what it was like to be young, to never forget that they were once wild and unhinged, and somebody had to rein them in. And the same grace that they were given, they need to extend to their children. I pray that the children will understand that the parents are just doing the best they can to try to keep their lives in order and to try to keep them safe and to try to provide for them. There's no handbook. We just do the best we can every day. But Lord, I pray for you to intervene in these families and to heal these families in the name of Jesus. Forgiveness, mercy, grace, peace, bring it all in Jesus' name, God. Lord, I know that there's some people standing here who are dealing with depression. They are at the end of their rope, Father. They are standing on that ledge. And they need someone just to look at them and say, it's a lie. It's a lie. The things that Satan is trying to tell you so you take that step or you end that moment, it's a lie. You have value beyond what you could possibly imagine. Before he formed you in the womb, he knew you and he called you and gave you a purpose. Do not believe the lie. If you have breath left in your lungs, then you have a purpose in Jesus' name. I pray against the spirit of depression, the spirit of suicide. In the name of Jesus, I pray against it. You have no authority. And Father God, I pray that your spirit will just indwell in every single person who's struggling with depression. Help them feel your arms of love wrapped around them. Help them feel the encouragement and the peace and the strength. And help them to be strengthened from the inside out, knowing that no matter what obstacles come their way, no matter how difficult things get, they are not alone. Not only because you walk with them, but there are people standing right beside them who have probably experienced the same thing. And it's time we start sharing those scars and lifting and building one another up. God, be with the church. Be with the church. These are difficult and desperate times, and we are teetering on the brink of disaster. I pray that you will restore a fire in the church. I pray that revival will break out right here at Fusion Church, here and in Madison and every other location for Pete's sake. Who cares where it is? Let revival break out here and spread to Ohio and spread to the outermost parts of the world, Father God. And may people see a light and turn towards you, Father. It is not too late, but it starts with us. It starts with us surrendering, setting aside our selfishness, our selfish desires, and being what we need to be for you, denying ourselves, taking up our cross, and following you. God, I pray for my friends right now. I pray for my friends that you will give them all peace, comfort them right now, meet them right where they are. And all God's people said, amen and amen. As you make your way back to your seat, I want to sing this song for everybody who stood and everybody who didn't stand. Listen.
Abraham and Sarah never thought they'd have a son. Then descendants came as countless as the stars. Moses and God's people had nowhere left to run till the waters of the Red Sea stood apart. So many times the light of hope was setting like the sun, and it seemed to the faithful it was over, it was done. But God sees a way when miracles are well beyond our view. His love saves the day when fear would try to tell us there is just no use. See, you can look the whole world over for the meaning of it all, for the purpose that mankind has always sought. In the end, you'll discover that there is no other answer but God.
Do you believe it? Listen. I know your heart is aching. The pain just comes in waves. And everywhere you look, it seems like there's no peace. You try hard not to give up, but the tears will not relent. Any minute now, you might accept defeat. And you stand there with impossible, the next words on your lips. And your vision has been blinded, and nothing's making sense. But God sees a way when miracles are well beyond our view. Oh, His love, it saves the day. Oh, when fear would try to tell us there is just no use. See, you can look this whole world over for the meaning of it all, for the purpose that mankind has always sought. In the end, you'll discover there is no other answer. Oh, but God. In the end, you'll discover there is no other answer. Every prayer,
God. Amen. How many tonight were blessed by Jody's ministry? Come on, how many were blessed tonight? Whew. Listen, if you were blessed and that's you tonight, I want you to tell Jody we are accepting some donations up here, a love offering on either side in these baskets this evening to send him on his way. You heard some of his stories, some of the hard things that he's been going through, and this is just going to further that ministry along, amen? And I think one thing that Fusion is always good at is we gather around people and we support them, amen? We are good at that. We are good at that. So tonight, I'm going to have the team back here put some music on, and I'm just going to bless you this evening, and as before you go, would you just stop up here? And bless Jody. You can shake his hand as well and get to know him. And we're going to pray over Jody quickly. And so if I could just ask you to bow your heads this evening with me, and we're just going to bless Jody as we go. Father gracious, Lord, we thank you for this evening. We thank you for the wonderful testimony. Father, it's only by your blood and through your stripes, Father, that we're here tonight, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that you have given this man not just a sound, but you've given him a purpose for that sound. And he's using it, and he's giving you his yes to you, Lord. I pray tonight, God, that you would bless him and his family with his daughter and decisions that they have to make this week, Father, and conversations that are going to be have. And I pray, God, that you would protect him, Father, as he travels even, Father, Lord. Lord, we pray that he is blessed in his new positions that he has, and the new work that he's working on. I know that he's working on a second book in his mind, and I think that that's just going to come sooner than later. You're going to speak things to him, Father, in the middle of the night and give him words to pen on paper and just new insight for his ministry that you've given him, Lord. I pray tonight, Father, that you would continually bless him and his wife and their marriage, Father, and protect them, Father, Lord Jesus. Put your angels around him, Father. We pray, God, this evening that you would, we would take this offering, God, for Jody, but we really are taking it to bless you, Lord, and we just give you the glory and honor for it. I ask, God, this evening that you bless all of us as we leave here and protect us on our vehicles and our drives home. I thank you for every person here, Lord. Father, you've given us a light that's not to be hidden. We are a city set upon a hill. And Father, we're going to go out and do what you tell us to do, Father, Lord. We're coming out tonight changed. Some of us have been set free. I believe chains have been rattled off tonight, Father, in the name of Jesus. I also believe that the lives are going to be transformed and there's going to be new testimony out of the songs and the words that we heard this evening. Yes. I thank you, Father, for every soul here tonight, Father, and everyone that's represented. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Bless Jody tonight.
These tears would just be tears falling down my face, and this hurt would just be hurt with no healing on the way. Thank you, Jesus. Heaven changes everything.